All right, let's do Impact while we wait for the battle to the death to begin.
All right. Impact opened with Ric Flair in the ring. He was still upset about Eric Bischoff being fired. Said Hogan had been fucking with him for a long time. Did not use that exact word. He called Hogan down to the ring. Hulk came out and, make a long story short, he offered Flair a job as a judge in the gut check challenge. And Flair was hesitant, but he eventually agreed, and that was that. It was much longer than I've described here, and also much better, because Ric Flair is awesome.
Actually, I thought it was pretty lame. Mm. I mean, the delivery was fine, but it was like, Hogan came out, Flair didn't like him, Flair thought he was fucking with him, and then after all that, Flair just goes, all right, I'll do it.
Well, yeah.
I mean, heavily edited.
Hey, I just, Ric Flair entertains me. That's all I ask for Impact.
Are the animal cruelty people going to come after me for feeding a crane fly to this cat?
No.
Is this cruel and unusual punishment or, no. or animal abuse or something no. to kill this crane fly?
No. Hmm. Don't be an idiot. No.
Hope not.
Velvet Sky and Brooke Tessmacher vowed that one of them would beat Gail Kim for the title.
I mean, I can't personally kill a bug. I feel bad about it, but it's my cat. She's hungry.
What about a spider?
Oh, I'd stick her on a spider immediately.
But could you kill a spider?
Oh, God, no. I'd run in fear. I hate spiders.
Okay.
I would rather be in open water with, like, a crocodile than in my bedroom with a spider.
You're dumb.
No. No. I don't like any animal that has more arms and legs than a human or, like, a bear. You know what I mean? Like, animals should have two arms and two legs or four legs. But an animal that has, like, eight legs and multiple eyes, that's like something from another planet. That thing is terrifying.
How do you feel about snakes with no legs?
I'm fine with that because, you know, there's some people that have no legs. But I've never seen a person that had eight legs.
I've seen babies like six, but yeah.
I don't know. I never had a problem with snakes.
Okay.
Some people don't mention snakes around Granny or even Whitney. They'll both pee themselves. But I have no problem with snakes. But spiders, absolutely no buys. Or any bug with multiple legs. Like this crane fly. It's got looking like about 10 legs right now.
Has six. And two very long wings.
Yeah. All right. Go on.
Brooke Tessmacher and Velvet Sky versus Gail Kim and Madison Rayne. It was a knockouts tag match. The finish was actually great. It's Brooke and Gail in the ring, and Brooke throws a kick, and Gail catches it and starts to talk smack. And as she is talking, Brooke grabs her arm and hits Eat Defeat for the win. Mm-hmm. So she hit Gail's finisher because Gail was being an arrogant prick heel. That's tremendous. The match was what it was.
And in fact, it is true that there is a large valley between the breasts of Miss Tessmacher.
They look like fake boobs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unfortunate.
They're on their way to Slammiversary, so they're showing highlights of the past. The highlight here
was... You were talking about her boobs being on their way to Slammiversary, because they are.
Well, they are going to Slammiversary as well. Yeah. The highlight here was Jeff Jarrett versus Raven in 2003. This looked like something from an alternate dimension here in 2012.
That bug knows it's in trouble, by the way. It's just sitting there.
That's what bugs do. Those bugs especially just sit there. They're completely useless animals. I don't hate most bugs. I hate those. They're just gross. They serve no purpose other than to be gross. RVD did an interview in the ring. He's in the ring for like 2 minutes talking about how great he is and all he can do and how everyone pays to see him. This was a heel promo in every way.
But this is RVD.
But it's RVD, so people love him.
His haircut is atrocious.
He still has these shaved sides ponytail.
This isn't even shaved sides. It's like he almost just has a shaved head with a top knot at this point.
It's a ponytail mohawk is what it is.
It's hideous.
Yeah. So Bobby Roode came out. And it took a long time for them to announce that they were going to choose opponents for each other tonight. And then RVD said Roode would face Mr. Anderson, and Roode said RVD would face Jeff Hardy. Don't ask me why they waited until 30 minutes into the show to book these matches. Had Devon versus Robbie T. Devon is awesome.
Yes, he is.
I love Devon. And Robbie T is not awesome, but this is a fine match for, you know, 3 minutes on TV. And Robbie E got involved. He was in the ring. There was no DQ. They were doing stuff. And then he hit Devon in the head with a clipboard for the DQ. And he celebrated the title. So the Robbies versus Devon feud continues.
Can't wait for that.
Al Snow met with Ric Flair backstage. A meeting I don't think I've ever seen on camera before. And boy, did it look weird. Bruce Pritchard was also there. They are the three judges for the Gut Check Challenge.
Mm-hmm.
So it's time for them to have a meeting. I know Dixie Carter is a big fan of reality TV. This is where it showed. This was straight out of The Apprentice and probably dozens of other shows. It was three people having a conversation as dramatic music played in the background.
I love when the camera would randomly focus in on like a water bottle.
Yeah.
Is that what TV does nowadays?
Probably.
Sucks.
Yeah. So basically, Bruce Pritchard and Al Snow were trying to keep an open mind. Flair's mind was made up.
Yeah, he sucks.
He's small and he sucked.
Yes.
he's too small. He's small now, and he doesn't have the bone structure to get big.
Yeah.
And
he sucks.
And Al said, well, the X Division guys are small. And Flair said, the X Division guys are great athletes. This guy can't hack it.
Yep.
Ric Flair made this awesome.
It was hilarious.
Hogan and Anderson had a very wacky meeting backstage where Hogan made the main event for no reason, no DQ. Had RVD versus Jeff Hardy. They did all their spots. Roode came out with his belt. He tried to hit RVD. He somehow managed to accidentally hit Jeff in the back behind the ref's back. Then RVD hit a super kick and won.
This was like the pretty much the lamest Jeff Hardy, Mr. Anderson match that you could possibly have. Or Jeff Hardy and RVD.
Either way.
They just had a wrestling
match. They just did their
stuff. A short television match. It meant nothing.
They got all their shit in.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah. Joe Park Esquire found Bully Ray backstage. Said he still wanted answers about Abyss. Ray blew him off. Basically said, if you keep bothering me, you're going to be missing too. He walked away and Park smiled.
He admitted it.
He did.
You know, at this point, I can't fathom any fan not knowing that Joe Park is Abyss now that Joe Park has cut a serious promo.
It's not a screaming promo.
Well, no, but his voice, cadence, and such were exactly like his brother, which I guess they're brothers.
Sure.
They're brothers.
Hector Guerrero's promo sound like Eddie's.
I am waiting for, I don't know where this is going to go, but my dream scenario of Chris Park, actually having a legitimate brother that is his same size and such, and you could do the gimmick where, you know, for weeks, you never see Joe Park and Abyss in the same place at the same time, and then you build to the big match where Joe Park and Abyss are going to team. And everyone's like, oh my God, how are they going to do this? But in fact, there is a real Joe Park and a real Chris Park. And they team together. Or you just find another fat guy with a long hair you can put the Abyss mask on. You can still do my storyline. A lot of different ways they can go with this. I'm fascinated.
It is the best thing they've done in years. We had a great segment that started with something that annoyed me. They needed Borash to be out there or to be talking on camera. And so rather than have him be interviewing someone or a million other things they can do, he starts cutting a promo on Eric Bischoff.
Well, I think we missed the very beginning of this. I think the mystery cameraman interviewed him about why he did what he did with Bischoff the week before. So he was explaining himself for all of the fans that, in fact, don't go to Eric Bischoff's Facebook.
Okay, listen. Fine. Then it's the... They should not be talking about this anymore. This was an angle, whether it was Borash's idea or the cameraman's idea or whatever. It was 20 seconds of TV time dedicated to build up a feud that is over.
Well, yeah.
So
it was a post-fight interview.
The point of this was Boris was just there so Bully Ray could come harass him. He dragged him down to the ring. He cut a great promo on him about how, you know, he talked about the anti-bullying movement across the country, and he wanted to start a stop being a bitch movement. He was daring Boris to hit him or do something, and when Boris didn't, that just gave Ray more leeway to be even more of a dick. Finally, Austin Aries came out. He said Bully Ray had been making fun of him, the same thing everyone else had made fun of him his entire life, his size. Called him Blubber Ray. Said he was a spokesperson for both diabetes and buffets. Kept talking until finally Ray slapped the mic out of his hand and said, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? And finally, Aries lit into him. Beat him up. Had him beaten down to the corner. Bunch of geeks ran out, held him back. And Bully Ray got to his feet, kicked Aries in the balls, and walked out. A great segment.
This was pretty much a perfect segment.
Yeah.
Jeremy Borash is a perfect victim. Bully Ray is a perfect bully.
Yes.
And Austin Aries, of all the small guys in the company, if you've been watching Austin Aries for any length of time, particularly when he's a heel, and particularly when he's dealing with fans, here is a guy who is small, but I honest to God believe this guy would fight anybody. And I believe that he would stand up to Bully Ray and just call him on his bullshit, which yes. is exactly what he did. And once he did, and once he laid into Bully Ray, Bully Ray, who is in fact a bully, as soon as three men were holding back the 5'5", 160-pound Austin Aries, once three men were holding him back, Bully Ray kicked him in the nuts. This was awesome.
This was a great, great segment.
This was perfect pro wrestling.
Yes. Bully Ray in particular was awesome here.
Yes, he was great.
This was awesome. Had a wacky meeting with Daniels, Kazarian, and Angle backstage. Just if it was that Angle warned them to stay out of his way.
Angle's like a babyface who's still kind of a heel, who's wrestling babyfaces.
I've given up.
Yeah, don't think about it too much.
Yeah. Throughout the show, by the way, just during matches, they never had a formal announcement, but TNA would very casually and subtly plug that the Impact is changing time slots. No big graphic, no commercial. Just, oh, by the way, if you happen to be paying attention during this match, we're moving. Had a six-man, AJ, Joe, and Magnus against Angle, Kazarian, and Daniels. As noted, Kurt is his own man right now. We'll say that. He does not like the baby faces. He does not like the heels either. So he tried to wrestle the entire match himself. At the finish, guys were running everywhere, and he caught AJ in the ankle lock. Kazarian tagged himself in. That pissed Angle off. And then Kazarian's plan was foiled. He was hit with a Styles Clash and pinned. So the babyfaces won. They all left together. Angle threatened his partners and then just gave up. And then Kazarian and Daniels were pissed. They said next week, either AJ reveals his secret or they will reveal his secret. There's a lot going on in 5 minutes.
Yeah.
We had the gut check challenge judgment.
You know what? Let me say this. When I first read about what they did, when I read the actual spoilers, where you had this guy, he didn't really look all that good in his match. They have the judges out there. Ric Flair and Bruce Pritchard both vote no, and Al Snow talks him into it. That's how it was explained in the spoilers. That is not what happened. What they did here actually worked. They had the guy come out, and they had all the judges talk about him and what they thought.
By the way, when you say they came out, they were all standing under spotlights.
Mm-hmm.
And again, the dramatic music was back.
Exactly like, was that the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire music?
It was that. It was...
I'm sure a million other stupid shows.
Whatever that other game show was, where Booker T looked dumb.
Bruce Pritchard and Al Snow have both seen a lot of Alex Silva.
Weakest Link, that was it.
They saw him in Ohio Valley Wrestling. I'm sure they saw him up in Canada or wherever. Ric Flair seen none of this guy. So, you know, Ric Flair goes first, and he stomps a mud hole in the guy and basically says, you suck. So they say, all right, Alex Silva. Actually, I think it was Flair and Snow both gave their vote first, right? So
Flair said no.
Flair said no, you suck.
Al Snow said yes.
Al Snow said yes.
And I believe
Pritchard gave him the microphone.
Okay, Pritchard basically gave him one last chance to impress us.
Yes, so he gave the microphone to him.
Yeah.
And Alex Silva starts cutting this promo, and he's cutting a promo on the fans, and they start booing him, which was funny because he's talking about his dad who has passed away, and he's doing this for his dad, and they start heckling him at this point. So that was nice. So the promo is just dying a death. I'm sorry to use that terminology. The promo is doing very poorly. So they go back to Flair, and Flair grabs the mic and just says, "Stop talking to the marks. Talk to us." And at that point, Alex Silva actually cut a goddamn great promo. It was only like 20 seconds. I gave him 30 seconds, but he cut a passionate 20-second promo. And the moment he was done talking, Flair looks at him and goes, "You changed my mind." And they went to Bruce Pritchard and he said, "You know, your match last week wasn't much, but you know what? You changed my mind right there as well. We all vote yes, you're in." And it worked. It actually worked in execution. When I heard about how they were going to do this, I thought, this is the worst. How can you possibly start the gut check challenge, have the guy lose his match, and then have the judges, two judges vote no, and have to be talked into giving a seal? That's the worst storyline I've ever heard to kick something off. But the way it worked out, even with him losing, because the key was, we've seen the kid elsewhere, he's done better, he didn't do well last week, he was nervous, but there's a lot of potential here. And then he talked his way into changing Ric Flair's mind. I actually thought the whole thing was great. I don't know if Alex Silva's ever going to be any good. I don't know. I was laughing with what Ric Flair was saying and everything like that, but I don't know if there's any hope for Alex Silva, but the way they did this here, I thought this really worked.
I really, really, really didn't like the game show elements that we talked about already. As far as the delivery of the content of the segment and Flair's promo and changing his mind and the judging panel and Silva's great promo, yes, the rest of it was good.
All right, go on.
And then in a main event, that was perplexing. It was Bobby Roode versus Mr. Anderson in a for no reason, no DQ match. They brawled on the floor a lot. They used a chair a little bit. And then at a random point, Bobby Roode is preparing to use a chair when Jeff Hardy runs in to make the save. So you've got a babyface who needs help to win a fair fight. It's always a good sign. So he fights off Bobby Roode, and he turns around, and Mr. Anderson gives him the mic check. And then Anderson gets to his knees and just looks at him. I think the idea is that Anderson thought it was Roode. But this is not made clear.
That was the idea, and it didn't work.
Boy, did it not work. The announcers were trying to cover it up. But, yeah. So then Roode hit Anderson with a chair and pinned him with a fisherman suplex. Then he hit both guys with chairs, and RVD made the save. Then RVD turned his back, and Roode hit him with a chair, and then the show ended.
Eh, wasn't sold on the final segment.
No.
But, like I said,
I was sold on it. Sucking.
The Borash Bully Aries thing was awesome, and the gut check thing ended up being awesome. Those two good things on the show. And the main event, it's not like the main event angle is awful. It's just...
it was dumb.
It's an angle.
Yeah.
It is an angle to set up a match no one's going to buy. So anyway, that was Impact, everybody. And, Crane Fly has moved.
Oh, God, it was just there. I looked at it a minute ago.
I saw it get away.
Do you see it now?
I don't know where it went. I'm kind of feeling bad about the idea of taking a life on the air as well.
Coward.
I know. And I kind of felt bad, too, because the little bug was sitting there right by the window. Trying
so
to
close
get out.
To freedom.
Yeah.
You're giving the Crane Fly way too much credit.
I know some people are going to be unhappy, but we are not, in fact, going to take a life here on this show. Besides, Snorky had her dinner. She is content now.
It is also known, according to Wikipedia, as a mosquito hawk, mosquito eater, or a gollywhopper.
A gollywhopper?
That's what it says.
I can't kill a gollywhopper here on the air.
Oh, if you saw the close-up of its head, you'd kill it immediately.
Oh, don't make me look at it. All right, everybody. To the back. Yeah. That was a great promo on Chikara that the Briscoes cut. That was money. All right, let's get into the Impact show here.
Impact opened. Bobby Roode came out and bragged about embarrassing or beating up a... Anderson and Jeff Hardy and Rob Van Dam all by himself at the same time. So RVD came down to beat him up. Roode tried to flee. Anderson cut him off. Threw him in the ring. So Anderson and Rob Van Dam beat up Bobby Roode by themselves.
2-on-1, advantage baby faces. Yes, yes.
At this point, Jeff Hardy came out to make the save. Wait, no. Jeff Hardy came out to make it 3-on-1, advantage baby faces.
Yeah.
And there's like some, something in his soul realized how unfair this was. And just at random, he attacked Mr. Anderson.
Well, they've
and they started
been
brawling.
Not getting along.
Yeah, but he didn't come out and attack Anderson. First, he attacked Roode.
Sure.
Then he attacked Anderson. A brawl broke out. Geeks came out to separate them. At this point, Hulk Hogan appeared. He had a great idea for a main event. He's going to do a four-way tonight. And everyone had something to gain if they won. If Jeff Hardy or Mr. Anderson won, then they would get the title match at the pay-per-view. If RVD won, he would get to choose the stipulation for his title match at the pay-per-view. And if Roode won, he would get to pick which one of these three men he wrestled at the pay-per-view. Which to me sounds like not much of a reward. He had far less to gain here than the other three men. So he asked Rob Van Dam if he was willing to make this sacrifice. This was not a sacrifice, this was a gamble. Regardless, Rob said yes, and so that was the main event. This was a wacky, stupid segment.
Yeah. I've seen worse.
Yeah. Bully Ray cut a promo saying Aries was small. He was going to take someone out tonight, and we'd all see what he was talking about. Gail was talking about Brooke backstage about how she wasn't all that hot and none of her wins were fair. Madison just wanted to talk about her gear. She had a guy to impress. Brooke Tessmacher versus Velvet Sky.
Wow, was this match bad.
I need to get some
quotes. Have I mentioned yet how bad this match was?
I need to get some notes.
This
some
match was
my notes.
Really bad.
It was poor. The first thing they did was they had an ass contest.
That was fine.
TNA called it Dancing Cheeks. Taz went with Buttocks Shakeabout. So yes, as noted, this was a goddamn terrible match. And they fell down a lot. They took 14 steps to get halfway across the ring. They missed time to come back. It was bad.
I love the spot where Velvet went for her wacky whatever it is, her pedigree. And Brooke escaped and rammed her into the buckle. And then Brooke fell down.
I like the spot where Brooke went for a monkey flip out of the corner. And Velvet shoved her off. And Brooke landed on her feet. And then collapsed.
The power of falling from two feet. Yes.
And landing on 2 feet.
Too much for her limbs.
So given the beauty of the women involved and the wrestling talent on display, this was really no different than watching oil wrestling at your favorite gentleman's establishment, except it was free. So I give this a thumbs up.
Well, and they were clothed.
There's that, too.
Therefore, I give it a thumbs down.
Because there's no actual nudity.
Yeah.
Yeah, as a wrestling match, this was amazingly bad.
Let's be honest here. Mm-hmm. I give it a thumbs in the middle because I was entertained for the 2 minutes
it
lasted.
That's what I said. The bad things in the show were so bad they were laughable.
This was a legitimate example of so bad, it's good.
There was a point where it looked like we couldn't figure out if there was an editor or not. Because it appeared to be an edit. It appeared that Brooke specifically had magically rotated 90 degrees in the ring. But what was left was so bad we couldn't believe they didn't edit the whole thing out. In hindsight, I can't believe they just didn't take this match off the show.
This was, no joke, one of the worst matches of the last few years.
It was deep, deep, deep in a negative stars. On that note, Crimson came out. Oh, wait, I'm jumping ahead a bit. AJ didn't want to talk about Daniel's secret. Hardy said he's going to win his match. Then Crimson came out. It was supposed to be Crimson versus Matt Morgan for the final time.
Because God knows we've... It's time to wrap this feud up.
Before Morgan could get in the ring, Ray attacked him with a chain.
He attacked Morgan.
Yeah. Thank you. He attacked Morgan with a chain. He hit him with a chair. The chair actually hit the post, but Morgan gigged. And they stretchered him out. They took a long time at doing this injury angle. They got a lot out of it. Then afterwards, Crimson cut a promo about how here he was, still undefeated, and Morgan couldn't even make it in the ring. He ordered the referee to count Morgan out, and the ref did, so Crimson won. TNA mentioned here that Crimson has been undefeated for 16 months.
Yeah. This goes down in history as the
most ineffective
win streak of all time.
Speaking of time frames, I forgot to mention this. In the opening segment, Bobby Roode mentioned that he's like a week or two away from becoming the longest reigning champion in company history.
That's amazing.
That is ridiculous. It seems like he's defended this belt like three times.
Well, he won it in October, so we're looking at, what, eight months?
Was it really that long ago?
Yeah, October, Bound for Glory. New.
Huh.
I'd like to note, by the way, that I am not a fan at all of Crimson's in-ring abilities, but he has a fine personality in promo as a heel.
Promo's fine.
Yeah. Very good, actually. Yeah.
We had an RVD video package. Talked about Greek mythology. He talked about it was either Achilles or Theseus. I thought he said Theseus. But regardless, this character was given a choice of deciding between a short, adventurous life or a long, dull one. And he wanted.
I presumed he was talking about Achilles, but I'm not a.
I was once a student of this kind of thing, but those years are long gone. The notes I'm reading here, which is from your site, your front page, that says Achilles. I may have heard him wrong. I also just saw, unfortunately, Wrath of the Titans, which has Theseus in it. So maybe that's why I thought I heard that. Don't see that movie, everyone. It's dumb. Anyway, point here was that Rob wanted to be, a hero of Greek mythology.
The story was that Achilles was given the choice of having a long, peaceful life or a short, heroic life. And he chose the heroic life.
I could have sworn I just said that.
Well, RVD's point was that he was exactly like Achilles.
Yeah.
He wanted a extreme life, presumably that would end early.
Well, yes.
That was distressing.
Then they showed him in deep thought with an American flag behind him.
Yeah.
I don't know who has this report here. Jeff Hamlin. He needs to be kicked square in the balls. Austin Aries defeated Zema Ion. He gave this match 2.75 stars.
What?
This match was awesome.
This was the anti-Velvet Sky versus Brooke Tessmacher.
This was ruled.
This match was so awesome that I made Vinny watch this match a second time from start to finish.
I did not protest.
And I enjoyed every moment of it even more the second time.
Austin Aries, Zema Ion looked good. Austin Aries looked several levels above everyone else in the world.
He was outstanding.
This was, God.
I will go as far as to say, I am not a man who swears much. I am against profanity. But these goddamn fucking idiots in WWE that would not even sign this guy for tough enough.
Yeah. Yeah, they're dumb. They're dumb.
Let's look at the successes of Tough Enough. Cameron. That's where it ends. Everybody else that they picked as a future star. Gone.
Yeah.
And Austin Aries didn't make the cut. Austin Aries didn't make the cut for Tough Enough.
Yeah.
He fell to Big Andy. Who, by the way, now can't even make it into TNA. Astonishing. Not really astonishing. And you know what? It's astonishing. It is. Daniel Bryan and CM Punk are headlining a goddamn pay-per-view, and somehow Austin Aries couldn't make Tough Enough? Idiotic. Complete lack of an eye for talent in WWE these days.
Hell yeah.
Anyway, Austin Aries is awesome. This match was awesome. He's turned Zema Ion into a perfectly acceptable X Division wrestler, which he was not when he first came to TNA.
That's a good point.
Yeah. So, congratulations to Austin Aries for truly being the greatest man alive.
You are this week. Daniels and Kazarian were backstage. Kazarian was a little reluctant about exposing AJ's secret. Daniels said, nah, fuck it, we're going to do it. We had another RVD promo. Oh, God, this one. Rob Van Dam Rob Van Dam cut a stream of consciousness promo, rambling on forever and ever and ever. It may have been one giant run-on sentence, now that I think about it. It took him about 2 minutes to say he was going to pick a ladder match.
Yeah, in the middle of the show.
Yeah, before he had won.
Yeah.
So, Daniels and Kazarian hit the ring. They called out AJ. AJ walks out in sunglasses, beard, and the fanciest ass jeans you ever saw.
Heel turn coming. Douchebag jeans.
They were douchebag jeans. It's a good word.
And didn't take his sunglasses off till the end. Growing the beard. This is inevitably, for all you listening right now, listen to me. Inevitably, he is turning heel.
I need someone to go back over the past decade and do all the AJ turns. It seems like it's been 3 a year.
Well, he's been there for a decade.
I realize that.
Yeah.
But it's been a decade of...
It hasn't been that many turns. I'll bet he's turned 3 times.
Nah. Been more.
Maybe 5.
So, they had a series of photos. Now, keep in mind, like a month ago, AJ was wrestling Kurt Angle, and he gave him a piece of paper, and he was distracted and pinned, and he was so distraught by this piece of paper, he didn't even care about losing the match.
And by the way, this should be easy to keep in mind because, in fact, they showed a replay of this before this angle.
Yes, yes.
They showed us AJ being handed a piece of paper by the heels, and he looked at it and expressed concern.
In fact, he asked, "Where did you get this?"
Yeah.
He did not deny what was on this piece of paper. So he came out here and claimed to have no idea what they were talking about.
That's what he did.
They showed him one photo. It was AJ and Dixie standing somewhere having a conversation. AJ replied, direct quote, "whoop-de-doo." He was right. But unfortunately for him, there were more photos. The second photo showed him with his hands on Dixie's face, looking lovingly into her eyes. There was a third photo that showed them kissing. Ooh.
Oh my God.
AJ was distraught. He had been exposed. The heels left him in the ring. They put the photos at his feet. AJ removed his glasses. He was flustered. He was ashamed. The crowd chanted, "AJ."
Yeah. Way to go, buddy.
And should note that as soon as Impact ended, we saw Dixie Carter on MMA Live. She was not talking about AJ.
Yeah, no one brought it up.
Nope.
Craig Carton didn't say, "What about this AJ fella that's licking your chops?" Maybe the photo was flipped. What do they say in Photoshop? Flip horizontal or rotate? Anyway, maybe he was
so they're
giving
actually
her
lying on top of her
CPR.
I see.
Yeah, maybe she was choking on a chicken bone and he had to go down there and help her out.
Maybe.
I don't know. I didn't write this story.
I didn't.
But
either.
I will say that Chris Daniels, AJ Styles, and Kazarian, their performances here were excellent. And Daniels in particular came across as a guy who, why is he in TNA?
Well, that's true too.
Well, actually, nowadays I can't even say that because, like, I don't know. I'm down on WWE of late, so it's not like they'd be utilizing him significantly better than he's being utilized here. But he deserves to be on the biggest stage that they could find.
He did have great delivery when he pointed out, "You know, AJ, you've been the poster boy of this company since day one, and now I know why."
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Daniels was awesome here.
Yeah. Speaking of awesome, I legitimately love this. Devon beat Robbie E. Here's the finish.
Yeah.
Devon was beating up both Robbies by himself at ringside. He threw Robbie E into the ring. He hit a spine buster, and he pinned him.
The setup was a punch outside the ring.
Yes.
Yep.
He destroyed both men.
Mm-hmm.
So then Robbie T got in the ring. He hit Devon from behind. Robbie E was still selling the spine buster. And when I say selling the spine buster, he was laying in the center of the ring doing a starfish with his arms and legs spread as wide as he could.
Yep.
So that Robbie T had no place to slam Devon, had to slam him over by the ropes.
Vice versa.
What did I say?
Oh, no, you're right. You're sorry.
Ah, got one. And so, yes, the Robbie versus Devon feud continues. The other best part of this, Robbie T is the bouncer, so he has the list.
Yes.
You have to have your name on the list to get through. They had the bejeweled list. I believe it said, quote, "The list, bro."
Yeah, that's what it said. Fabulous.
The list, bro. Great. That is great. We had a James Storm video package. He is working on his ranch. Did a lot of soul searching. Wasn't sure he was going to go back to wrestling. He's not used to working hard and failing. It was good.
I got to say one thing, one big positive about Impact lately. Is their personality profiles and video packages have been awesome. Every single one they've done has been good in some way or another. Well produced. Gets you thinking about the guys. Even the Rob Van Dam thing. I was fascinated listening to him compare himself to Achilles. It's like,
it was different.
I could not tear my eyes from the screen during this. And the James Storm ones were awesome, but he's a great talker anyway. But all of their video packages, all of their personality profile pieces have been great. So, way to go, Impact. Excellent job.
Speaking of way to go, Impact, out came Joseph Park Esquire.
You know, I had an idea, by the way.
All right.
Earlier in this show. Joe Park Esquire comes out and he's just looking around and smiling. He needed entrance music. And I've got the perfect tune for Joe Park. What do you think, Vinny?
Someone needs to take Impact and put this song over clips of the Joe Park segment.
Yeah.
Just turn it down. Don't turn it off.
He was so happy when he came out.
He was looking all around. He was looking around in awe at the Impact Zone.
My God, I'm in the Impact Zone.
I can't believe I made it. He goes to climb into the ring. He had never been in a ring before, so this is a great difficulty. He had to struggle to figure out how to fit through the ropes. And he gets in the ring, and he starts cutting a promo. "Hi, everybody," he says. But he's new, so he didn't realize he needed a mic.
Yes.
So he gets, 15, 20 seconds in before they hand him a microphone. Then he turned his back to the hard camera.
Which Taz noted.
Yeah.
Facing the wrong way.
Because he's not a wrestler, he's a lawyer. Yeah. He doesn't know how to cut promos and stuff. So he eventually figures it out. He's still happy to be there. So he's not used to addressing large crowds. Says everyone knows he's looking for his brother Chris. You know, Abyss. This is the best catchphrase of the year.
I like how he showed the height of Abyss, and it was significantly lower than himself.
Yes. Well, I guess Joseph's little brother. So, So the crowd was chanting, I believe they were chanting Chris Abyss.
I think they're saying, "Where's Abyss?"
I think later they were definitely chanting, "Where's Abyss?" So he announced that he had determined Bully Ray was in charge. He was all his clues pointed to Bully Ray as being the man who had taken out Abyss. Bully Ray appeared.
That's supposed to be like a record screech. It's the best I could do.
Fine work. Bully Ray appeared. He did not know. He had no connection between Joe Park and Abyss. Just besides the brothers, obviously. He said that this is not a courtroom. This is a wrestling ring. You have no business here. So Joe Park started needling him about all his failures, how in Abyss's last night he had beaten Bully Ray, and then 2 weeks ago D-Von had beaten Bully Ray, and a week ago Austin Aries had beaten up Bully Ray. He said, "How's that bullying thing working out for you?" So Bully Ray shoved him down, and his glasses came flying off, and Joe Park cowered in fear, and then Bully Ray walked out. And Joe Park composed himself and then started to giggle.
Yeah. I like this segment.
This
I thought it was awesome.
This is awesome. Then this whole storyline, every segment that Joe Park has been a win. This is the best idea they've had in years.
Yeah. I hope there's like a... I mean, I presume there has to be a long term here, but...
I am assuming they must have some kind of payoff in mind.
I am just hoping to God Almighty that Chris Park has a secret twin brother.
Yes.
That's where we're going here. If it turned out that, in fact, Joe Park is not being played by Chris Park and it is a different guy, this would be the best storyline ever.
Yeah.
There's so much potential here.
Ah, this is great. Anderson cut an annoying promo. What else is new? Angle said he didn't care about AJ's controversy. He was just going to make him tap out on Sunday. They're having a match.
By the way, I'm going to go back to Joe Park for a second. How did this guy go for so long with a mask on?
See, good question.
He's got such a great expressive face. It's a great promo, too. But I said this a long-ass time ago when Biss was feuding, I think, with Hulk Hogan. And he was cutting these promos out. He was going to kick Hulk Hogan's ass. I was like, God damn, this guy's a great promo. He is a great promo. And now I can add, I'd be happy with Joe Park playing the Marine. Because I now have proof that this guy's a great actor.
Yeah.
He's doing a great job playing a lawyer. He's got his glasses and his suit. He's just great. He's awesome. He's just awesome. So anyway, I got nothing but great things to say about Joe Park. Anyway.
So we had a main event. It was the four-way. It was basically 7 minutes of guys hitting big moves. So at the end, Hardy hits the Twist of Fate on Roode. Anderson runs in, hits the mic check on Roode, and then rather than make the cover, he tackles Hardy out of the ring.
What an idiot.
What a dumbass. So poor Roode has now taken two finishers, and then RVD followed with the frog splash, the third finisher. Robert Roode was killed. RVD pinned him. So it's a ladder match at the pay-per-view. RVD pulls the ladder out of the ring. He climbs it. He's happy. Roode is scared. Anderson and Hardy are still there.
That was a great finish, by the way, aside from the absolute idiocy of Mr. Anderson.
It was a great
finish. Which actually plays into his character, so.
Sure.
He's an idiot.
Sure. So, everyone's basking in the moment, and then there is a dong sounds, and who should appear on the top of the stage but Abyss!
Abyss is back.
For the first time in months, Abyss shows his face. Well, kind of. He has a microphone. He has a warning for his little brother. Says you're getting too close to the fire. You need to back off before you get burned. And everyone was scared of Abyss. The show ended.
That was awesome. You know what's great about the whole Abyss Joe Park thing as well?
Besides everything?
No, there's one little thing that I just thought was so awesome. And that is that when Abyss comes out as Abyss, he takes his teeth out. So he's got that big, I can't say smile, but whenever he bares his fangs, he's got two teeth missing in the bottom row. And of course, Joe Park's out there with the big old smile. He's got all his teeth. You know, at some point in the storyline, when somebody makes the devastating accusation that Joe Park and Chris Parks are the same guy, or I guess Chris Park. But anyway, regardless, when that accusation is made, Joe Park must point out, but wait, I've got all my teeth, and give a big smile. I love that little detail. I think it's awesome. And the fact that, you know, Biss has long hair and his brother doesn't. There's a lot of ways they could go with this, and this is not... You want to know positive? I'm going to tell you positive, which is amazing. The positive of the Joe Park storyline is that it's not in WWE. Because they'd fuck it up 7 ways from Sunday.
No, Impact has been way, way better than WWE lately.
TNA does, in fact, have long-term planning.
Yes.
Now, often the planning sucks. But in this case, if there's a good story here, we're going to see it played out to the end. Unless something horrendous happens to somebody. So, I'm very excited that the Joe Park storyline is taking place, and it's taking place in TNA. Or at least I can believe that if a conclusion is coming at Bound for Glory, it's probably going to play out through Bound for Glory. So, I actually don't know what... I don't know anything about the storyline, except I hope there's a real-life twin of Chris Park. So anyway, that was the show, everybody, and it was great. It was a great show. So anyway, check that one out on your DVR.
To the back!
I suppose we should get started. Let's go in descending order of awful today. How about that? So we'll start with the TNA pay-per-view.
This is a good show. TNA opened with Samoa Joe and Magnus versus the best team in the world right now, Daniels and Kazarian. It was a fun match. They got the heat on Magnus. Joe got to run wild. The champions hit their finisher and made a cover, but Magnus got pulled out of the ring, And then shortly thereafter, he got sent back in, and the heels hit something resembling total elimination for the clean pinfall win. New champions. Joe Park Esq. Was in the crowd. For some reason, this match upset him. They won clean.
Yeah.
But this is a perfect pay-per-view opener.
I enjoyed this match greatly. I was sad Joe and Magnus lost, but I was only so sad because the best team of all time won.
You put it the perfect way. The right team won.
The right team did win this match. And that is Daniels and Kazarian, two awesome men.
We should also point out the Impact crowd was going crazy for really the entire show, most of it.
You know what's funny is, I'll be perfectly honest here, I always thought Frankie Kazarian was very overrated. I always heard about these great matches Frankie Kazarian had, and I was like, it's fine. He is a fine, independent-level worker. He's not great. I don't think he's ever going to be anything special. But man, you put that guy with Chris Daniels and shave his head, and these two are my favorite team in the world right now. They're great!
Yeah.
And Kazarian is awesome in his role of being the sidekick to Chris Daniels. Or vice versa. I'm not exactly sure who's in charge here.
It is a little confusing, but yes. The point is they're great together.
Yes.
They have
much better together than Kazarian is in a singles.
They have both reached the I don't give a fuck stage.
Yeah!
And that's good.
That is actually good. When you care too much about wrestling, this business will just eat you alive. When you get to the point where you're like Chris Daniels and you're 40... and you've had this job for many years, and you'll have it for many years to come if you want it, and you're making decent money, and you only have to work when you want to, and you just go out there and start having fun.
Yeah.
It's probably the best time in his career right now for Chris Daniels.
Could be. We had Brooke Tessmacher versus Gail Kim. You recall that 48 hours before this, I guess 72, we watched Brooke have the worst match of the year. Funny thing. You take out Velvet Sky and put in Gail Kim, and the match gets much better.
Not only much better, this was a good TNA women's match.
Yeah.
They didn't miss one spot.
No.
Nothing looked stupid.
No.
Brooke looked great in terms of, you know...
Well, she always looks great.
Brooke Tessmacher.
Yeah.
But a perfectly fine match, and I guess that answers the question that didn't need answering. Velvet Sky is the worst wrestler in this country.
Yeah.
On a major league level.
And descending, by the way. She's declining. She's entered the decline phase of her career. Yeah.
By the way, I was alerted by somebody that, in fact, Velvet Sky has been wrestling for approximately a decade.
Somehow, this is going to sound weird, but that doesn't surprise me.
It baffles me. Just
how she could still be so horrible.
Because I have a theory that I actually developed from watching you. That no matter how bad you are, if you do wrestling for long enough, you'll be passable.
I see your point.
You know?
I see your point.
By the time you were headlining, if you want to call it that, in Tulalip Championship Wrestling, you were a...
I could hold my own in Tulalip.
You were actually one of the better workers on the card. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
But it took 10 years for you to achieve this level of mediocrity.
Sure.
But still, you rose above your horrendousness. And Velvet keeps getting worse.
Yeah.
I don't even know how it's even possible.
Yeah, Brooke, we all know how Brooke looks, and she's clearly athletically gifted. She's at a level above most women in either of the two big companies. It's kind of funny that she's been around for years and they never actually bothered to really teach her to work.
I think the thing with Velvet, I have a theory. Mm-hmm. She's hot and she's got big boobs. And so all of the guys in the company don't have it in them to say, Velvet, you really suck at running the ropes, so let's go in the ring before the show and let's try and learn how to run the ropes. No one has the balls to tell the hot girl that she's no good at this. Except me, apparently. And I don't work there. And it wouldn't do any good if the girls told her, because it's, with the exception of Gail, as some others there as well, but in some large part, it would be the blind leading the blind. But anyway, she wasn't on the show, so who cares? She can ruin the match on Thursday, in fact, in a three-way. Yeah, that's what they're doing. Gail, Brooke, and Velvet in a three-way. On Impact tomorrow.
I bet it sucks.
We'll find out.
Borash interviewed the new tag team champions. Kaz said that AJ had made himself the face of the company by whistling Dixie.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas he and Daniels had been beating men and winning titles. And Daniels also gave us permission to worship him. Very gracious. We had Devon versus Robbie E and Robbie T in a handicap match. It was fine. Robbie's worked together until Big Rob hit a power slam me to cover. Robbie E pulled him off. They bickered. Then Big Rob got scary and Little Rob started to back down. And then Devon recovered, shoved them both together, and schoolboyed Rob Terry for the win. It was fine. And then actually, it was better than fine. It was good. And then the Robbies teased a breakup, which would have broken my heart, in fact. But thankfully, Rob Terry just hugged Robbie E, although he kept shooting him mean looks afterwards. So I don't want this team to break up yet.
It's way too early.
Yes, it's way, way, way too early. And Rob Terry as a singles act is no buys. At least with Robbie E, he's funny.
The story of this promotion is guys that are better in a team.
That's largely true. Almost everyone, in fact. We had Jeff Hardy versus Mr. Anderson. This started off very clunky. Anderson was fucking things up, but he was doing things like arm drags and hip tosses and making them look just bad. And then he started to do arm bars and chin locks, and we were like 5 minutes in. And then things got significantly better at the end. We had a lot of big moves. Anderson went for a senton, but Jeff got the knees up, hit a senton of his own, but Anderson kicked out. They tried to do the yay and boo punch spot, but they were both faces, so nobody really got a reaction. And then Anderson hit a schoolboy. The ref counted three. Hardy kicked out. No one knew what was going on. Anderson was pissed that he had won. And then they shook hands. And the heat was not there for this, as it was for most things in the show, because it was two baby faces. But as a match, it was okay, even with a shit finish.
Anderson, I actually thought the match was all right. I think I like this match probably better than anyone else in the world, and I'm probably... Well...
Many people like Mr. Anderson more than you do.
Yes. But I could not help but notice during this match that he's so heavy.
Yeah.
And I don't even mean like he's a big fat guy, although he has put on weight, but it's like gravity affects him more than your average man. Every step he takes is this giant heavy stomp, and he goes up heavy, and he lands heavy. He's just heavy all the time. It must be, like, excruciating to work with this guy, which, in fact, is why he was fired from WWE, yes. But he's got to lighten up.
Christy gave Austin Aries a question from Twitter. They did this a couple of times in the show, and it appears they're not doing it the smart way, where they take a question from Twitter, they tell the guy, we're going to ask you this question in 10 minutes, think of something good to say, and the guy cuts a promo.
And it's not a stupid question.
Well, this is a pretty stupid question. Are you intimidated by Bully Ray?
Well, they could have asked much dumber questions like they have in the past from his Twitter followers. True.
So, yes, Austin cut a promo. He vowed to hit Bully Ray with his brain buster, and when Ray was flat on his back, then Austin would be the bigger man. We had an interview with Joe Park Esq. In the crowd. Best thing in Impact, best thing in wrestling. He talked about going on all the rides at Universal. He made friends with the crowd.
Well, the ones he could fit on, he noted.
He did say that he was too fat for some of the rides. And he referred to that Bully Ray fella. Had roughed him up, and so he had missed Abyss's big return on Impact. But right now, he was just... You know, he hinted Abyss may show up, but right now, he was just going to enjoy Austin beating up Bully Ray. I love this man.
It's too early for Joe Park merchandise, but they need to make a shirt that just says, you know, Abyss!
And it's just a hand.
Yeah.
Just a hand doing the motion.
I'd buy that.
Wow, that would be such an awful shirt, but I would buy it too.
I would buy that shirt.
You put the hand on the front, and then the back it says, you know, Abyss.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or just, no, you have the hand and it says, you know, dot, dot, dot. And on the back it just says, Abyss! It's got to have a big exclamation
point,
too. That might
work, too. That might work, too.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think what a Joe Park Esquire logo would be. Somebody with a graphic arts background get on that. Crimson came down to the ring, said he had an open challenge, wanted the ref to count 10 so he could be declared the winner over nobody. Instead, Eric Young came out, who is not quite a nobody. He told ODB, his wife, quote, hold my stuff while I go fight him. So they had a match. It was an Impact match. ODB got involved. She hit Crimson with her boobs. He no-sold this. He shoved her down. This made Eric mad. He was so mad he took his shorts off. He stripped down to a way too small pair of Speedos. Ran wild for a bit. And Crimson threw him into ODB. And then hit him with the Riding Bomb, which they are calling Red Sky. Which I actually think that's a cool name for a move. It was fine. It was an Impact match.
Crimson is a much better speaker than worker. Newsflash!
Yeah. Bully Ray also answered a question on from Twitter, he said. He said he didn't do Twitter, but when he was on Twitter, he trended on Twitter. And he plugged his MySpace page. Bully Ray and Austin Aries had a great match. There was one terrible moment when Austin went up top, and as he's standing on the top rope, Bully Ray hits a big boot to the face, which is impressive by itself. And I'm sure they intended here for Austin to end up on the floor. I don't think he was intended to land back first on the guardrail.
I don't know what happened. I think he just, like, lost his balance. I think he was supposed to, like, just jump off and do a half turn and armpit the rail like Rob Van Dam does in every single match he wrestles.
Yeah.
But instead, he fell off backwards and goddamn near killed himself.
He came up with bruises, welts, and scrapes all over his back. This looked horrible. So, Bully Ray, being a pro, and maybe this is what they had planned anyway, but he just started hitting Austin in the back really hard. He hit him once, and he would walk around and taunt the fans, and they would go, boo, and Austin would sell and cry, and then he made his big comeback, and they started kicking out of big moves. Aries actually finally hit the Brainbuster. It was awesome, because he hit a dive. Actually, I'm getting ahead of myself. Bully Ray was the one trying everything, and Austin kept kicking out. And then Bully Ray grabbed a chain. He was desperate to win at this point. He had tried every move in his arsenal. He grabs a chain, and this throws Joe Park Esquire into a fit.
A frenzy.
He cannot stand by and watch this crime. He comes barreling down to ringside. He starts screaming at Bully Ray from the other side of the guardrail. So Bully Ray grabs him and drags him over. Joe Park cowers on the ground, whimpering, basically. At this point, Austin has recovered. He hits a big dive. He throws Ray into the ring. He hits a missile drop kick. He hits the corner drop kick. And he hits the Brainbuster, and he makes the cover, and it was not the finish. That was awesome. So then Ray tried a powerbomb, and Austin flipped out, and he hooked the last chancery for the submission win. Bully Ray is a bully, so the instant he got caught in this hole, he tapped out quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe Park just applauded from the ramp. This match ruled.
This was an absolutely awesome match. It was, well, it's exactly what we were talking about before the match even took place. Bully is an awesome bully.
Yeah.
And Austin Aries is the awesome little guy that won't give up and is not intimidated. And they built a match around that, and they're both awesome workers, and so it was great! This was like 2 thumbs up. Easy. Oh,
this is 6 thumbs up. We had Kurt Angle versus AJ Styles. They did a promo with AJ where he refused to comment on the photo of himself making out with Dixie. So, when Kurt's a babyface, he's suddenly a great wrestler. Many, many times over the years, I've seen Kurt Angle as a heel be out-grappled in a match. And I always think, that's fake! Now Kurt's a babyface, and he was allowed to school and humble AJ over and over again, and it was grand. So then finally he offers AJ a leg and dares him to try a takedown. And so AJ teased a takedown and then kicked Kurt in the face and unloaded with forearms. Heel turn continues. They had a good match. It was like Hardy and Anderson in that they were both baby faces and the crowd was not sure who to cheer for. So it didn't have a lot of heat. But eventually Kazarian came down and got involved and he distracted AJ and this let Angle hit the ankle lock for a submission. So Angle won. Then after the match, Daniels and Kazarian attacked AJ. Kurt threw them out, he beat them up and threw them out, and then he hugged AJ, so this will presumably lead to an awesome tag team match. I do not like this as much as Austin and Ray for a few reasons. First of all, the biggest one is just the sustained lack of heat, because the crowd didn't know who to cheer for. And I understood why Joe Park was interfering in the Bully Ray match, because he's got a beef with Bully Ray, and he didn't want to see him win with a chain, because that would be a crime. Whereas I didn't really know why Kazarian and Daniels were... Why do they care if AJ won this match or not?
I didn't like this as much as other people either. I thought it was a very good match, but I did like the Austin Aries Bully Ray match better. And that's all I got to say about that.
Bobby Roode beat Rob Van Dam in a ladder match for the main event in the main event for the TNA title. For the first, like, 80% of this, if you've ever seen Rob Van Dam do a ladder match, this was one of them. It was like watching a Raw match in 1993. And then they were doing... It was mostly... I've seen... Well, most ladder matches have been stupider than this. And then Rob took a spine buster onto a ladder that was sitting on the mat. That was dumb. So then Bobby's climbing a ladder in the middle of the ring. Rob tries to jump from the top rope and land on the ladder. He misses. His leg goes through it. He has to sell like he's blown out his knee. Then they tried another finish where Rob took a bump off the ladder. He smashed his head on the back of his head in a chair.
What an idiot.
At first glance, I did not think this was that bad, and then they showed it from many angles. This was awful. And Roode got the belt and won. Kind of a nothing match.
Yeah, it was all right. I thought it was better. It was better than I expected. Let me just put it that way.
Yeah.
I wasn't expecting it to be bad, but I thought it was kind of funny because Dave was like, it's either going to be great or it's going to be horrible. All ladder matches are.
And he was wrong.
And I thought, I expect this to be a perfectly average ladder match. And I concluded it was a slightly better than average ladder match.
Yeah. So, yeah, this is a... I think you like, as a whole, I think you like this pay-per-view a lot more than I did, or at least more than I did. But except for the Bully Ray match, I really didn't think anything was that great. But I understood why everything was happening. Everything went as long as it needed to. Nothing went overly long. I never felt insulted or ripped off or anything like that. So these days in pro wrestling, that's a thumbs up.
To the back!
I'll say. Let's move on.
All right. We watched Impact tonight. Robert Roode came out. He was bragging about his big title win over RVD at the pay-per-view. He said next week would be the date he marked the longest reign in TNA history. He was going to celebrate. He called out Hulk Hogan because he had some demands for a celebration. He wanted a redecorated dressing room with fancy furniture. He wanted chilled champagne. He wanted green M&Ms. And Hogan said, listen, I've seen a bunch of world champions. Lou Thesz, Harley Race, Ric Flair, the Hearts. And he said, even I had held the belt once. I laughed. And then he said, all that's true, but fact is, you're not the longest reigning champion yet. And he tore up the list of demands. He announced that next week, Roode was going to defend his title on Open Fight Night. And then things got confusing. And I remained confused until literally the last match on the show. He brought out like 15 men. And he said, one of these guys is going to get a title shot, so I need to narrow it down to 4. I don't understand. So, he booked 3 singles matches and a battle royal.
Let me explain.
Please.
Because I really have been liking Impact lately, and I like the pay-per-view, and I want to continue to like Impact, but I hate Open Fight Night. It doesn't make any sense. Perhaps somebody can explain it to me. But when I hear Hulk Hogan say, anyone can challenge anyone, to me that means anyone can challenge anyone. But in fact, it does not mean anyone can challenge anyone when he says anyone can challenge anyone. What it means is, next week on the show, he's going to spend the entire show eliminating these 4 men one at a time until he has chosen one man to face Bobby Roode. Now, that's all fine and good, but let's say that AJ Styles does not get chosen to face Bobby Roode or Kurt Angle. When you tell me anyone can challenge anyone and that person has to accept, if AJ Styles is not chosen, why doesn't he just challenge Bobby Roode anyway?
I don't have an answer to that.
I don't have an answer for that. I'm sure the answer will be something like, well, that's not what they do. Hulk Hogan chooses one champion, and then he decides who's going to face that champion, which to me means, well, then anyone cannot challenge anyone. Why doesn't everyone under 215 pounds next week challenge Austin Aries? Why don't they do that? They're not going to. We're going to have random people challenging random people, and it's going to happen about three times, and that's it. So I don't like open fight night. Perhaps there's a better way to describe it. Perhaps there's a better way to do it. Perhaps they could do something like on open fight night, we're going to choose one name out of a hat, and that person gets to challenge anybody they want, and the other person has to accept. But the idea that anyone can challenge anyone, that makes everybody look stupid who does not immediately challenge the champion of their division. All the women are stupid that don't come out and challenge Gail Kim. All the cruiserweights are stupid that don't come out and challenge Austin Aries. Every male on the roster is stupid that doesn't come out and call out Bobby Roode. Everybody looks stupid. I hate open fight night. I hate it. I hate this concept. And Hulk Hogan doesn't seem to have any idea what's going on again.
No, this segment ended, and yes, as noted, Hogan appeared to be narrowing it down to four men to fight Bobby Roode, so I didn't know what was going on. Was it going to be a gauntlet match? Was he going to have to defend his title five times or four times? I was left very confused by the segment, but A, I don't care its impact as long as I'm enjoying
myself. That's the problem. I've been enjoying Impact, and I want to be able to care about everything. I don't want to get mad at the show.
My standards by a decade have been ruined. So the interaction between Hulk Hogan and Bobby Roode was a lot of fun. That part was great. And so I give this a thumbs up, even though I was left bewildered by the end. We had our first qualifying match.
That's the other thing, too, by the way. Maybe there is like a great logical explanation for open fight night, but clearly none of the viewing audience, if you and I hate this segment so badly, can figure this out. I'm sure somebody's going to email me, some viewer, and go, Bryan, I watched the show last night. I knew exactly what was going on the entire time. Fine. You're in the minority. The majority of people cannot figure this out. When Hulk Hogan can't figure this out or do a good job explaining it on television, that's a problem. If you've got a great idea, that's fine, but it needs to be explained very clearly and concisely to everybody, and the holes need to be closed. This is the thing that annoys me the most. Close the hole of why isn't everyone challenging the champion? Why isn't everybody on the roster coming out and challenging the champions last week? The rules are anyone can challenge anyone, and that person must accept. So therefore, if you're not allowed to come out and challenge Bobby Roode next week, then the whole thing is bullshit. It's wrong what we are being told.
Had Bully Ray wrestling Rob Van Dam in the first qualifier. Rob Van Dam versus Bubba Ray Dudley in 2012. And I was watching this, realizing that, and it occurred to me that almost nothing about Rob Van Dam has changed in 15 years. He's a little slower. Same gear.
But you know what?
Same
this
moves.
Match was a lot safer than it would have been 15 years ago.
That's a good point. And shorter.
Yes.
They had a match. It was fine. Bubba Ray won with the cutter. So he was one of the final four, I guess.
One of the final four who will be eliminated and therefore next week will not get to challenge anyone that they want to.
So after the break, he was backstage. He was upset about the Kardashians. Because they're anti-bullies.
What?
That's what he said. You left the room. You left the room like six times during the show. At one point, Craig turned to me and said, does he even work anymore?
How dare you, Craig?
Well, you missed Bully Ray talking about the Kardashians. So, Joe Park Esq. Arrived.
See, I did see this.
He apologized for sticking his nose where it didn't belong and interfering in Ray's match with Austin Aries. He said his brother, Abyss, had mentioned getting too close to the fire, and he thought maybe that fire was Bully Ray. Ray just warned him to stay away, and he flipped his tie, and Joe Park was shocked.
Yes.
That a man would take his necktie and flip it about.
Indeed, he was shocked.
Not even angry or offended. Just it never occurred to him this could happen. Disbelief is the expression on his face.
The thing with Joe Park is if I took a photograph of you and I said, act shocked, The photograph would come out exactly like Joe Park looked at this moment.
I hope I could do as good.
Wide eyes and a big round mouth.
Let's move on. They plugged King Mo's arrival in TNA, or as Taz called him, King Mo.
King Mo.
Then something bewildering happened. They aired the segment from MMA Live with King Mo and Dixie and the Bellator dude.
And most importantly, I had to watch Craig Carton on this show.
Your favorite.
I actually was more infuriated by that than Open Fight Night, if that's even possible.
Not a fan of the man.
I'd like to challenge Craig Carton for Impact next week. Does that count? Does he have to accept if I do this?
I don't see why not.
Hmm.
But the Craig Carton turned to the Bellator guy and asked, do you think your fans, will there be a backlash that King Mo is doing these two sports? And then Craig says, no, they're totally different. Nothing in common at all. He may as well have said, one is real and one is fake.
Well, actually, at one point during the original interview, that's exactly what they said.
Yeah. I guess they edited it out, but it sure sounded that way still. And Dixie talked about how she'd wanted to do this for a long time, but she couldn't find anyone with the balls to work with them. It's basically what she said.
You know what I did love about this? It was so wacky. It's like, hello, Dixie's fucking AJ.
Yeah.
Nobody bothers asking this question when she's here on the show.
No.
I realize they were discussing something different, but she is the center of controversy right now, and she's just sitting there talking about King Mo.
Yeah.
I guess there's nothing you could really do, but I just thought it was hilarious. You know? I don't know.
Gail was backstage bitching about Brooke, Tessmacher, and Velvet Sky. Madison wasn't listening. She just wanted to fix her hair. Gail accused her of having a crush on someone. Madison ignored her and walked off. Tessmacher and Velvet arrived, and they warned Gail that one of them was going to win the title tonight. Basically saying it's going to be 2-on-1 advantage babyfaces.
Yes. A very popular...
A TNA tradition.
Yeah.
We had our battle royal. Bunch of guys. Also ODB. She dumped Crimson. Well, to be fair, ODB and Eric Young and Crimson all eliminated each other. They all three of them brawled to the back. Yes.
The undefeated Crimson eliminated immediately by a woman.
Yeah. Worse, Eric
Poor
Young.
Bastard.
So, one of the people in this battle royal fighting for a shot at the World Heavyweight Champion was Garrett Bischoff.
Yep, Garrett.
Now, Garrett was not the worst wrestler on the show, as we will get to shortly. But my lord, is he horrible. And poor Devon had to sell for everything this guy did.
Probably going to get a TV title match next week.
I'm sure he'd probably win.
Mm.
It was...
I should know this. Cringe, since the spoilers are out.
Cringeworthy and exposing the business is all I can say about Garrett.
That's something important, by the way, that we should mention.
What's that?
No one has mentioned yet, that I'm aware of, that Impact going live all summer means that Garrett Bischoff will be wrestling live on television every week.
Yeah.
That will be no good.
No. So he eliminated Devon here. AJ then immediately eliminated... Garrett screaming, get out of my ring. Which is probably what they were all thinking. Came down to Gunner, AJ, and Aries. Aries and AJ had a great little mini match for about a minute and a half. And then Gunner ran in and threw Aries out. And then AJ immediately threw Gunner out. So AJ won the Battle Royal. So he's one of the final four guys.
Taz called this the best Battle Royal he'd ever seen.
He did say that.
Hmm.
He may have been fibbing.
That was a lie.
So after the break, AJ's still in the ring.
It's a good match, though, for a battle royal.
It was a better-than-average battle royal, thanks entirely to AJ and Austin.
Yeah.
Which should not surprise anyone. So AJ's cutting a promo. He vows to beat Roode if Hogan gives him a chance. He started to talk about the pictures with Dixie. Said things were not as they appeared. He and Dixie were both happily married. At this point, Daniels and Kazarian came out. Chris Daniels said, it's obvious you have a phenomenal high-flying moveset. I love Chris Daniels.
Chris Daniels is awesome.
Yes.
He is a megastar.
Kazarian, I guess the gimmick is that he wants to like AJ, but he can't. Because Daniels was just being a dick and making fun of him. Kazarian was asking AJ to explain himself, and AJ couldn't really. So Daniels, they pulled out an iPad, and they showed a video of AJ and Dixie walking down a hallway and then apparently being pulled into a hotel room. And AJ acted like he'd just been caught red-handed. He shoved Daniels. He stormed to the back. Kazarian looked disappointed in AJ. Daniels just said, "Well, I told you. I told you." This is a great segment, thanks mostly to Christopher Daniels.
Chris Daniels was a hero here.
He's awesome.
The one thing about the angle that's odd is that I have just figured since day one that AJ and Dixie are in fact fucking and he's turning heel. But with each passing week, I'm starting to think, okay, well, maybe he's innocent and he's going to remain a babyface. But perhaps there's a great explanation for this that I cannot envision in my head. But every time they show AJ evidence, he's shocked and embarrassed.
Yes.
And he runs away.
He is. His hands in the cookie jar.
Which suggests something other than innocence.
Yes. That would be guilt.
If, in fact, AJ is correct, and there's a logical explanation for all of this, then why are you so concerned? Why are you so worried that there is a video of you walking into a hotel room with this woman if, in fact, you moved in there on a business meeting? Why don't you just explain that? Why do you shove the man and run off if you are innocent?
You know, we've never met AJ's wife. Maybe she looks just like Dixie.
That could be. Maybe he married Dixie's twin sister.
Sure. Or a clone.
Never thought of that.
Joe and Angle had a confrontation out by the lock, the trucks. Angle slapped him. Joe started beating him up. A bunch of guys came in and broke it up. We had Mr. Anderson watching the finish to his pay-per-view match on an iPad. You'll recall that the ref fucked up in count of three when he shouldn't have. So Anderson was trying to determine whether this win was fair or not and said ultimately it didn't matter. He was giving Hardy another chance tonight. Although it wasn't really him giving Hardy a chance. It was Hogan who booked the match, but whatever.
We determined during this segment that John Cena is, in fact, more annoying than Mr. Anderson.
John Cena is so much more annoying than Mr. Anderson. It's not even close.
I don't know what Anderson has, then.
His gimmick's dead?
Yeah.
He's got an iPad.
John Cena's killed Mr. Anderson's gimmick. He does have an iPad. Although maybe he just borrowed Daniel's iPad.
That's true. They may only have one in the entire company.
They have one in the entire Impact Zone. One iPad.
Chris, I need the iPad. All right, thanks. Had a video of the 10th anniversary of Slammiversary coming up. So they just basically showed every big move in the history of the company over the past 10 years. This was good. We had Jeff Hardy versus Mr. Anderson. It was there. They had a match. It was clunky. Jeff did a cradle. And he had Anderson down. The ref counted three. Anderson kicked out at 3.1. Acted all stunned that the ref counted three. The idea, I'm sure, was supposed to be just the shoes in the other foot. The ref fucked up again, this time for the other guy. But this sure looked like Anderson got beat to me.
Yeah. Had been a creative finish, actually.
Yeah. So the two guys hugged afterwards, so they are still friends or whatever.
I love that. What a great babyface Mr. Anderson is. You beat the guy, you gave him a rematch, and he beat you, and you're like, bah!
Fuck it.
That's all right. I don't care. I mean, I'm not saying you should have beat him up or anything like that, but it's just kind of funny.
All right. We had a match.
Oh, no.
Bryan knows what I'm talking about here.
Oh, no.
Gail Kim versus Brooke Tessmacher versus the worst wrestler in the world, Velvet Sky. And this may have been her worst match.
Really? I thought she was just your average Velvet Sky in this match.
Bryan?
Yes?
At one point in this match, I say this without exaggeration, Velvet Sky struggled to fall down.
Yeah.
Velvet had gravity helping her and fucked up the spot. Then she tried to stand up. This was also a challenge.
Yeah. We can now confirm that I have seen three matches involving Brooke, and the two that were horrible also involved Velvet Sky. And the match sheet that and Gail Kim as well. And Gail Kim had one one-on-one match with Brooke, and it was very good. Therefore, this to me is scientific proof that Velvet Sky is a horrible in-ring technician.
Yeah. I like the part where Gail had Brooke in, it's either a half crab or a sharpshooter or something, and Velvet walks over and applies what I think was supposed to be a dragon sleeper, but no one knew. She just sort of grabbed her head.
I don't know who put this match together, but they're employed.
Yeah. Yeah. So, eventually, Velvet hit her move on Brooke, and Gail threw her out and stole the pin.
Oh, come on. Really?
I swear to God.
That's finishing this three-way?
Really?
Oh.
Somebody stole the pin. Had our main event, Kurt Angle versus Samoa Joe in the last open fight night qualifying match, best of four thing. This was it's going to sound worse than it really is. Probably the worst match these guys have had together. Still a good TV main event. Actually, this finish was unique and creative. Joe is setting Kurt up for the muscle buster. He's got him up on the ropes, and Kurt keeps fighting off. And finally, Joe walks in, and Kurt goes over the top of the sunset flip and pins him.
Yep.
Great. So Roode comes out, and they have a stare down, and the four guys, Bully Ray and Hardy and Kurt and AJ, they all come out and have a group stare down, and show went off the air.
Yeah, that was it. This show was average impact. I was not blown away by it. Next week is open fight night, and we'll see how I feel after open fight night next week. Maybe it'll be so awesome that I'll be a big fan afterwards. Do we get gut check challenge next week as well?
I think so.
I think we do. I think it's Joey Ryan against Austin Aries. I believe that's what we get.
That could be good.
To the back. Let's start Impact.
All right, Impact. I've mentioned several times I like this show. The first segment, at the time, I did not know what to make of it. I later decided I did not like it, but Hulk Hogan was in a room. Also, and there was Kurt Angle, Bully Ray, Jeff Hardy, and AJ Styles. And I actually didn't realize this until right now, but these are the four men who qualified for title consideration last week.
Yes.
I actually literally just now made that connection.
Well, here's what I can tell you.
Okay.
Every week before open fight night, they determine four people who are going to fight for the world title. And then on open fight night, Hogan eliminates them one at a time, and the final person gets a championship match. This is separate from the open fight night where anyone can challenge anyone. Now, despite explaining that, I still absolutely hate open fight night in the sense that I still don't fully get it. If they explain, perhaps, that everybody draws a number, and numbers 1, 2, and 3 get to come out and call somebody out, and that person has to accept, fine. But they've got everyone backstage, babyfaces and heels alike, and the show opens, and I'm jumping ahead, but just bear with me. The show opens with Gail Kim coming out and making a challenge. Why did Gail Kim get to make the challenge? Why didn't Matt Morgan get to make a challenge? Should he be there? Why didn't Rob Terry? Why didn't the Motor City Machine Guns get to make it? They're all back there. Why are they not? Is nobody clamoring to come out and make a challenge? Who decides who gets a challenge? What if everybody on the entire roster wants to make a challenge on the live show? Is the show going to be 8 hours? So I'm still not a fan of open fight night. It's too convoluted a concept. At least now I understand the world title deal. The world title deal is completely separate from everything else, as is the gut check challenge. It is too many things on one show. But with that said, I actually did not hate the backstage segments with Hogan, because he's going to do this on every show. We just need to accept that on every open fight night, Hulk Hogan is going to grill all four men or women, and at the end of the night, he's going to choose one of them. I actually had no problem with any of these segments except for the goofy music. I am not a fan of goofy music in the background in wrestling shows, because a wrestling show, to me, it's not your average television show. It is a fake sporting event. And I'm pretty sure that if you took the camera backstage at an NFL game or the Super Bowl or whatever, and you were interviewing the coaches and the team or whatever, and they were having a discussion that happened to make air, they would not edit in dramatic music in the background. Am I wrong, Vinny?
Not if it was presented like this.
Okay.
And you'll see, yeah, you know.
Well, yeah, the theme of the thing, right?
Well, you will see, for example, the open to most UFC shows, there's fighters talking with dramatic music playing, but it's clearly a post-edited deal.
Yes.
This was theoretically an actual conversation we were eavesdropping on.
Yes.
So, yeah. So they're in there talking, and as noted, there's dramatic music playing. They are zooming in on everyone's faces. The camera's being very shaky. It's supposed to be like super intense, high drama television. It just came off kind of hokey. The very first thing Hulk Hogan did was hold up the format for the show, and he announced it was taped on the 15th and airing on the 24th.
Yeah.
Telling the viewer at home that this show was not live.
That doesn't matter, because it's live from now on.
I guess. So then,
that at least explains the post-edited music.
They started talking... Sure. They started talking about how Roode would be the longest reigning champion in company history. By the way, I have been mentioning for a while, I cannot believe this, and it's sort of confirmed. Somewhere in the latest Observer, Dave pointed out he's the longest reigning Impact Wrestling champion.
Yes, since the TNA title was created in 2006.
Right. So this Jeff Jarrett had the NWA belt for longer.
Yes.
So that doesn't count. So that makes some sense. But they're still claiming he's the longest champion in the 10-year history of the company.
Well, that's a lie.
Yes. All right. So the point is, he's about to break this record for longest reign. Kurt Angle is not impressed, and he mutters something about how it's not how long you hold it, it's how many times you win it back. That sounds backwards. So they're all bickering and bitching about who should get a title shot and whether tag belts are more important than singles belts and whether TNA titles are more important than those from other companies. This went on and on and on. Bully Ray said he was the most legit guy in the room. He said this 3 feet away from Kurt Angle. Jeff Hardy appeared on screen. Your wife from the kitchen shrieked and screamed, "What the fuck?" That is the only correct response to seeing Jeff Hardy on television. So, eventually, Hulk determined, I don't know how...
She was baffled this man painted his face for meetings.
Yeah. I'm baffled by most things Jeff Hardy does.
Yeah.
So, Hulk eventually eliminated Bully Ray from contention. I really don't honestly understand how or why on how. I don't know why, what his criteria was here. Bully was upset and said, "Eric was right about you," and walked out. This took 8 minutes. And I was...
That was the first of many segments.
Baffled and confused by this. And you pointed out, it's better than Laurinaitis.
That's true.
That is damn true.
That is true.
Goddamn true. All right, Gail hits the ring for a promo. She's talking about how she's the most dominant knockout ever. Madison's in the background just checking her makeup in a mirror. So she still has a crush on someone, and we're not supposed to know who. The best part of this segment was, as Gail is talking, they show the locker room backstage, heels and baby faces all together, and Daniels is in the middle giving her a giant thumbs down. He didn't like this promo. He was not a fan. So Gail calls out ODB and Eric. So we got Eric Young and ODB versus Gail Kim and Madison for the Knockouts tag titles. Eric actually got to wrestle the girls this week.
Yeah, he did hip tosses and body slams.
There also headlocks and go-behinds.
Yeah.
This is much, 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 much better than the usual horrible comedy he does. They also showed a commercial letting us know that Brooke Hogan is coming.
Mm-hmm.
And they showed her tearing her shirt off like her father.
I have not been
not to show her boobs, you pervs.
No. I have... it's our abs, though. Not bad. I will say that. Not the biggest Brooke Hogan fan, but she has some abs. Anyway, I'm not the biggest fan of Eric Young, as everybody's well aware. But when Eric Young ripped off his trousers, and he was wearing a pair of trunks that are way too small, and he's ready to go to town on the ladies... And ODB from the apron yells at the top of her lungs, put your damn pants back on. What are you going to do? Knock him up? And he hung his head in shame and tagged out. I laughed hilariously.
This team is growing on me.
They really are.
This team is very, very...
And it's all ODB.
Well, then...
So they play off each other well.
Yes.
But I'm not sure that Eric Young with any other woman would have been
Is. No. This would not work with Eric Young and Velvet Sky.
She completes this act.
Yes. So, eventually, ODB went for a body slam on Gale, and Madison tripped her from the outside and held the leg down so the heels won, but most importantly, it was a fun match. So...
It's all you can ask for.
So, are they the new tag champs now?
I don't think so.
Just occurred to me.
I don't think
titles... I could have sworn that when they first announced this deal, that you could challenge a champion, and they'd have to say yes.
I don't think you can challenge them to a title match, though.
Huh. All right.
Well, I can find out.
It is bad... I should point out that we don't know this answer right now.
I just assume the matches were non-title unless Borash was out there.
So Hogan was on the phone with someone who was apparently on their way to the show, and Hulk hung up the phone.
Yes, Eric Young and ODB are still champions.
Hulk hung up his phone and said, this is a quote, holy shiz.
Yeah.
RVD came out. He called out Gunner. I was thinking, why on earth would you call out Gunner? And then lo and behold, they showed a video. Gunner had laid out RVD in January. And this was Rob's chance for revenge. So, they had a match. It was completely unremarkable until the finish. Rob won with a frog splash, which doesn't sound unique, but Gunner was so goddamn far across the ring. And Rob gets up on the ropes. And they put the camera on the crane right behind him. You can see Gunner way off in the distance, almost over the horizon. And Rob hits this enormous splash and pins the man. It looked really cool. Bryan, your thoughts?
I actually am doing a project here as you're talking about this. I am looking at the list of all of the other TNA champions of various sorts. And I'm going to find out if anybody has a longer reign than... Bobby Roode. Wouldn't it be funny if, like, a set of TNA Knockouts champions had a longer title reign than Bobby Roode?
That actually would not surprise me at all.
I think that would be awesome. Let's see here. So far, nobody who has held the TNA television title has outdone Bobby Roode. Let's try the tag team titles. AJ and Tomko actually came close. That's kind of funny. Hold on a second. How about that? He has actually, he just, as in today or whatever, beat himself. James Storm and Robert Roode, as Beer Money, held the title for 212 days, and Bobby Roode has just surpassed 212 days. How about that? All right. Let's check the X Division Championship. I would guess that, in fact, nobody has held it.
I bet the record here is maybe 3 months.
Yeah, let's see.
I bet no one's made it 100 days with that title.
List of TNA X Division champions. Well, no. Petey Williams, 158 days.
I was wrong.
Christopher Daniels, 182 days.
I was very wrong.
And looks like nobody...
No one else?
Oh, well, how about that? Austin Aries.
100 some days.
256. Oh. Austin Aries is, in fact, the longest reigning champion in the history of TNA wrestling.
When did he win that belt?
He won that belt in September 11, 2011. This may be total days. That might be the problem.
Ah, as you...
That might be the problem. But still, even total days, he is the closest that anyone has come. Total days for the women's champion, nobody has come close. They'll go, though, Gail Kim in two reigns at 192 days, so she's getting close. And TNA Knockouts tag titles, nobody's come close. And there you go, they are not lying.
All right.
All right.
D-Von hit the ring. He called out Garrett. Because Garrett had eliminated him from the Battle Royal last week. So here's what happened. They wrestled for a few minutes. Robbie E and Robbie T attacked them. And the babyfaces worked together to fight them off and clear the ring. And then they hugged. The best performer in this segment was, in fact, Joe Park Esquire.
Holy Christ, he was good. All show.
Because, you see, Devon was cutting a promo where he vowed to be a fighting champion for all the people. And he got the, you know, everyone did the automatic applause for this line. And they cut to Joe Park. They didn't identify him. They had not shown him, I don't think, to any point in the show. They showed him in the crowd as Devon vowed to fight for all the people. And Joe Park Esquire quietly, silently mouthed the word,
"Wow." Yes.
He was awestruck by the noble claims of Devon here to fight for the people.
Yes. And by the way, as an update, Austin Aries has, in fact, held the title consecutively for 256 days. So he is a longer reigning champion than Bobby Roode. And in fact, he has had the longest reign of any single person in TNA dating back to the inception of TNA Impact.
And he's not getting enough credit for it.
No, how about that? He is the greatest man alive.
I guess so.
Congratulations to Austin Aries.
We had a second meeting with Hulk and the gang in the office. Eventually, Hulk eliminated Jeff Hardy. He said he needed something he could bet on 190%. It's a random number.
He doesn't understand math.
So Jeff was
a little worse than me.
A little bummed, and he left, and that was it. Kurt was impatient. He wanted a decision. Hulk said they would make a decision in the ring. They had this hashtag open fight night graphic in the screen. Only, you know, you can't put it in the corner of the screen because then people with low def TVs won't see it. So it's like in the middle of the screen. This annoyed me badly. It's 2012. We can stop catering to the low def TV crowd.
Well,
let's put it over in the corner. Maybe better to not have it on the screen at all. I don't need 2-hour reminder to tweet about this if I want to. So we got a Joe Park Esquire video package. Bully Ray then hit the ring for a promo. He was ranting about how pissed off he was, and he called out Joe Park Esquire in the crowd. People were happy about this. Joe Park was stunned, gobsmacked. He was completely unprepared. He eventually came down to the ring. He requested a microphone. A young lass ran up, handed one to him. He turned around to the ring.
That'd be SoCal Val, I believe.
Sure. He turned to the ring, stopped, turned back to the girl and said, "Thank you." And then turned to the ring again.
Yeah.
Everything Joe Park does is awesome.
He is.
Don't know if you've noticed this.
Amazing.
So he got in the ring. He said that he was not a fighter. He was intimidated. But he'd been in a lot of courtrooms, seen a lot of defendants, some guilty and some not guilty. And when he got in the ring, the fans were having fun and chanting yes, yes, yes for him.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time he got to this point talking about guilty and not guilty, the fans were silent in rapt attention.
They were actually silent in the good way, listening to every word the man said.
Indeed. So he claimed that Ray deserved a fair trial. Then he turned to the audience and said they could be the jury. I love Joe Park, but goddamn, what a shitty lawyer.
Well, Vinny, if we presume that in fact Joe Park is Abyss, he's not really a lawyer.
As a poor imitation of a lawyer. So,
well, he didn't say this was a legal proceeding. He just said that they were playing the jury.
I see. So he asked if anyone thought that Bully Ray was not guilty. The audience booed. Bully Ray raised his hand.
Yes.
This segment was so awesome, just right there.
He was quite great.
So then Joe asked if anyone thought Ray was guilty. At this point, Bully Ray punched him. He hit him with a chain a few times. He declared himself not guilty, and he left as Joe Park lay on the mat and sold. This segment ruled, and it's even better if you're following Joe Park Esquire on Twitter, which I should have had preloaded, but I don't, so I'm going to load that right now.
He had some great post-beating tweets.
He did. He's alerting us all to his condition. Many tweets throughout the show, which, by the way, show was not live. I know who he is. He's my number one suspect on Where is Abyss. Bully Ray, your actions, they hurt. But they are also more evidence. Hashtag guilty. Robbie E. tweets at him, "Park, if I were you, I would shut that hamster mouth up." He replies, "Your hair is a violation of everyone's constitutional right to not have to look at something so ridiculous." Then back on track. "My goodness, Bully Ray, that was uncalled for. You accosted me in front of countless witnesses. My stomach and back hurt terribly."
I like how at the beginning of the show, they admit the show is taped, and then dudes are tweeting.
Live tweets.
Live.
Yes.
For this taped mugging.
"Thank God they have these medics here on site to help me. Bully Ray is hashtag guilty. Please help me by RTing."
I should have RT'd that. Oh, well.
And then he gets a question from someone who was skeptical about the validity of Joe Park. He says it's either Chris tweeting or a TNA staffer, to which Park replies, "My name is Joseph, and our family last name is Park, not Parks. Are you one of those hashtag smarks that at typical ROH fan told me about?" I love Joe Park. Joe awesome. Park is the best thing that happened to wrestling in years and years and years.
Yeah. This literally is the best angle in wrestling right now.
Ever.
I don't know about ever.
Yeah. It's time for the gut check.
Notice I said, I don't know about ever.
Yeah.
You could try to convince me.
You will listen to arguments?
I will listen to arguments that this is the best angle ever. Yes.
It's great.
And again, I ask, whose idea was it to put a mask on this fella?
All they did was waste a decade of his career.
I guess.
Joey Ryan was the candidate on the gut check tonight, the Indie Geek Showcase.
Actually, let me say one thing about Abyss and his mask before we go on. And actually, this isn't quite as... This would be worse if it were in WWE. If WWE, if he, at least when he had the mask, he was able to create a monster character for several years. If WWE would have had him play this character, he would have been Santino for his entire career.
Yeah.
So, better off that he started out masked. Now maybe he can do both characters.
Just be Joe.
We'll see where they go.
Speaking of Joe, Joey Ryan was on Impact. He's cutting this promo before the show. And you see the empty arena and the ring behind him over his shoulder. And he's talking about his childhood love for wrestling and all he's ever wanted to do. Meanwhile, he's got his shitty indie wrestler haircut, his wacky mustache, his cheap sunglasses, his scarf, and no shirt.
And chest hair.
And, of course, chest hair. So, you got Joey Ryan versus Austin Aries.
I'd like to jump in here and just state that I like this show. I've liked Impact for the last several weeks now for the most part. Actually, I think last week I didn't like the show very much. But more times than not, I like Impact. But I must state again, for the record, how much I fucking hate Ultimate Fight Night or Open Fight Night. And the gut check challenge, I defended. I defended that Alex Silva gut check challenge where he had a bad match. He went way too fast. The judges wanted to cut him, but he cut a promo and he saved his career. He saved himself from being cut and got signed by TNA. I defended that. Now, we have not seen Alex Silva one fucking time since that gut check challenge. Not one time. Why would you bother doing the gut check challenge? And of all the people so far, and granted there have only been two, but Alex Silva was not ready for a contract. And I realize that you want to make a big... kind of a big bang when you start out. We do the gut check challenge. The first guy, bam, he gets signed. All right? I can understand wanting to do that. But if you're going to hire the guy, especially after he had a bad performance, you're going to hire the guy and give him a contract and make that known on national television, and then he completely vanishes until the next gut check. Why would we possibly care about this gut check? The last guy who won was never seen again. It's like Tough Enough. What happened to Big Andy? No one would care at all about the next season of Tough Enough. Because the only person that made it was Cameron, really, at this point. I guess there might be some more down the road, but... it's just... I don't even get it. I don't even get why they even hired Alex Silva if he was going to disappear for a month. It's the goofiest thing I've ever heard of.
I don't have any defense for any of these. All right. All your points are solid. So we get Joey Ryan versus Austin Aries.
Lucky him.
Yes. The announcers, by the way, were dropping some quality jokes about how Joey Ryan looks like a porn director. So, the best way I can describe Joey Ryan here is that he looked like a guy who should be doing jobs on Impact every week. He was not as good as Austin Aries. He did not look like a guy who was demanding to be on screen. But
looked a hell of a lot better than Alex Shelley. Alex Silva. I apologize. Alex Shelley is phenomenal. Yeah. He looked a hell of a lot better than Alex Silva.
Yeah. He looked competent for the most part. There was a point where he tried some wacky pump handle suplex and it did not look good. And Taz broke it down in detail how he had fucked this up. And then at the very end, and there's also a spot where Ryan hits his drop kick, which is good.
Yeah.
And maybe he was doing this for heel heat, but he hits this drop kick and then celebrates like it's the best thing anyone's ever seen.
I'm sure that was heel heat.
Yeah, because like 20 minutes later we saw AJ Styles. It was better. So, yeah. And then the finish, Aries goes to him with a brain buster and Ryan doesn't go up hardly at all. Aries has to muscle him up there and then just dropped him right on his head. Maybe on purpose. So, that was the end of the gut check. I guess next week we'll have Al Snow, Bruce Pritchard, and a mystery third man discussing whether Joey Ryan gets a contract. So, Roode and Angle and AJ all come out. Holt comes out from the ramp. And he decides AJ is getting the title shot. And his argument is, AJ knows the champ better than anyone.
What a stupid argument.
Yeah.
They made it very clear to the beginning of the show that if Bobby Roode defended the title successfully this evening, he would break the record, which was set by AJ Styles. So why not just very simply say, if you're going to try to break AJ Styles' record, you got to beat AJ to break it. Hello? That's not what they did.
No.
On the bright side, we got a 20-minute match.
A really good 20-minute match.
It was awesome.
AJ was having one of his days where he decides, this will be the time I kill myself. He took a suplex onto the stairs, which is actually much safer than it sounds. Hip toss onto the stairs.
Mm-hmm.
It was still much safer than it sounds, but it could have easily gone horribly wrong. He would have been hurt very badly. Then he got necked on the top rope and appeared to take Adam's apple first.
Clothesline turned a mass over tea kettle onto his head.
Yep. Spear, same thing.
Yeah.
So the end result of all this was that it was a very good TV match. AJ was constantly distracted. I don't know. He kept looking to the entranceway.
I think there was no one there, but he was expecting someone to come out.
Yeah.
Which is fine.
They finally showed Kazarian and Daniels on the entranceway at the end.
I think it came out after the match.
All right. So regardless, AJ is in position for a springboard, but he stops to look over his shoulder. He finally tries the move. Roode gets his knees up. He wins the Fisherman Suplex. Part of me is thinking it's time for Roode to get a new finisher, but
I actually thought he had a hell of a Fisherman Suplex the second time around.
All right. So it's not that it's a good or bad suplex. It's just that the world champion should have a better move than this.
Hmm.
So,
like an F-U?
Touche. So, point is, Roode won here. And this actually was, the Joe Park segment was my favorite part of the show, but the last part of this was really great. Roode starts cutting this promo about how he has made history. He's the longest reigning champion in the history of Impact Wrestling. He brings in a bottle of champagne. He calls Hogan out to drink with him. Hogan doesn't come out, so he starts the party anyway. They start spraying confetti. It is red and white and green confetti. So either Roode is Mexican or they just had extra confetti from Cinco de Mayo laying around. It's actually great either way. He starts pouring champagne on himself, spinning in circles, rolling in the confetti, having a great party all by himself. That was really what made it great. He was going over the top alone. So Hogan finally came out, probably because he was jealous Roode was having so much fun. And he starts to put Roode over about how he had earned his title. He had worked hard and earned respect. He said someone else wanted to celebrate too. Roode said, no, nobody else. He didn't want to share his champagne and his confetti. Lights go out. When they come back on, Sting's in the ring. He attacks Roode, beats him up. Roode bails. Hogan then announces that next week is the first week with a new time slot. And to kick things off, to open the show at 8 p.m., it's going to be Bobby Roode versus Sting in a lumberjack match. And show went off the air. And I did not like the verbal debate segments, I think that part is stupid. But really, other than that, I thought every segment on the show had a purpose. I thought almost all of them were entertaining. Everything was paced very well. The show flew by. And this was, in many ways, nearly a perfect pro wrestling show.
I thought the biggest thing was how excellently paced the show was. Russo is gone. Praise the Lord. The final segment, we had 35 minutes for a 20-minute Bobby Roode match. And then he set a record. And instead of going to the back for something else, they spent a good 5 minutes with him celebrating. He had confetti fall. He drank champagne. He poured it on his head and into his own eyes, which caused him to nearly go blind. I don't even think that was not a heel thing. That was, I think he usually pours water on his head and he poured champagne and forgot to close his eyes and alcohol got in his eyes and it sucked. But regardless, it was funny. And then he rolled around in the confetti and then they made the announcements for next week. And then they made your main event for next week. They took 35 minutes to do this. Way to go! That would have been 5 minutes back in the old days of Impact. And then there would have been 84 other segments on the show.
True.
That is the biggest positive change of Impact is the pacing of the show is slowed down. It's so much better now. And this is a fine television show. Now, I don't want, granted they don't have much competition right now. Raw sucks bad. But still, let's be fair. Impact is much better lately. A fine television program this was.